Bonjour Marc, bonjour Jean-Yves.
Bonjour, bonjour Jean.
So we are here today to talk about ECHO 2, ECHO 2. So it's a Walloon initiative aiming at accelerating the energy transition for the heavy industry in Wallonia. So Jean-Yves, can you set the scene for us?
Yes, of course, Jean, thank you for that. So the first thing I would like to emphasize before starting to explain what are the ambition of Europe for the objective for 2050. So as you see on this screen, there is a pretty ambitious target for 2050 in which the emission of the industry represent more or less 20% of the challenge. So the difficulty is, of course, to tackle with this objective and to be ready in due time and to have the time to deploy and be able to be the first area to achieve this zero emission in greenhouse. The difficulty is to know how we will do that. So you see here one extract of an EER report about the maturity of the technology we have in front of us to take that challenge and tackle this challenge. If some technology, a very few fraction of it, are just already mature, most of them are not at all mature. They are in earlier adoption phase, demonstration phase, and some are just really not mature at all. So it means that we have a lot of work in front of us to do that job and to develop the technology we will need in the future, and that's exactly the core of the ECHO 2 initiative. We see what are the different options the EV industry have to reduce their own emission. We have, first of all, the possibility to remove and replace the fossil fuel by using electrical energy, and that's the electrification of the processes. If not possible, we can, of course, transform this electricity, and it will be explained by Jean, into hydrogen and use this hydrogen. Or the last possibility for the renewable fuel is to transform and reuse more biofuel or biomass instead of fossil fuel. And at the end of the day, when we cannot do that, neither electrification nor using hydrogen or any kind of biomass, the only solution is to capture, concentrate, and use or sequestrate the CO2, the so-called CCS and CCU. Now I will ask Jean to give you some practical example of those different routes of differentiation of the industry. Jean?
Thank you, Jean-Yves. So let's look at industrial initiative, because some of them are tried, tested and approved, and we will start first with energy efficiency. So because the best CO2 is the CO2 which is not generated, we must have in mind that a lot of equipment, industrial equipment, operating today will still be operating in the coming years. So there is still room for improvement. Two examples here. On the right part, a combined cycle power plant, the example of what we have been doing a few years ago to improve the efficiency, above 62% for such a plant. There is still room for improvement. And on the right side, on one hot strip mill, the opportunity to use the water which is required to cool down the supporting skids, and this hot water is transformed into steam. This type of technology is well known, but not yet implemented everywhere. So as a comment, a lot of initiatives for energy saving are still available and could be implemented in other areas. Jean-Yves, what about energy efficiency at Carmeuse?
This is exactly the same as for the power sector. In the lime industry, there is also a room for improvement in the energy efficiency. And again, that's pretty correct that the best CO2 is the one you do not emit, of course, by reducing that. Here you see on the picture the different technology, different lime kiln operated in the world. On the right side, you have the less efficient kiln, the long rotary kiln with a high consumption of energy. And to do exactly the same job, you have the so-called BAT, PFR, parallel regenerative flow lime kiln, which are one of the most efficient process in the world. So by going from the right to the left, you see the possibility to improve that efficiency to reduce the emission. Carmeuse in his strategy has the target to have 100% of best available technology by 2022. Now, Marc, some example for the glass industry.
So some example for glass industry and for AGC. So we speak about the European production. So and we speak about float. So this is the main equipment where we produce, let's say, glass. And we have, let's say, about 16 of those kind of equipment in Europe. This is in average the relative specific emissions, let's say, for those furnaces, starting from 1990 to, let's say, today. So you see that, let's say, helped by each reconstruction of those floats after 18 years of working 24 hours on 24. We apply, let's say, our best technology. We do numerical simulations. We improve, let's say, the insulation of the furnace, the burning capability. We do best practices. And we improve by 31%, let's say, by this kind of, let's say, actions. And if you look, let's say, two specific cases, if we speak about Belgium, one in the north, with very recently, we rebuilt one of the furnaces that we have there. It's a small furnace, specialized in very thin, let's say, glass. And from, let's say, the end of the furnace to the new furnace, we reduced by 44%. And same example for one of the furnaces that we rebuilt in Wallonia, where we do, this is a big furnace, let's say, for this is one of the biggest furnaces that we have, and we reduced 23% of CO2 by energy efficiency action. After having, let's say, tried to reduce the CO2 that we produce, let's try to use the best way, the energy, meaning the way it has been generated first. And so we will speak about electrifications. This is a slide coming from McKinsey that is showing where are the technology for electrification depending on the temperature of the process. And you see that if we speak about low temperature, medium, high, this is technology that are available today. But I think that what is interesting here is that when you arrive to very high temperature, over 1,000 degrees C, you see that this is still at research of pilot phase, and we believe. And if I take the example of glass, so just for setting the scene, 1 ton of glass is creating 0.5 ton of direct CO2 on this kind of float furnace. Let's say 0.15 coming from the raw material, from the carbonates, and 0.35 from the combustions. The goal that we have in AGC is to become neutral CO2, especially in the float part, but not only. There is a lot of actions on increasing the recycling, going to, let's say, non-carbonized material, raw material, but and maybe, let's say, CCU and CCS for the remaining part. But this very remaining part, the key is first to use electricity. In fact, glass doesn't require to have, let's say, carbon. We just need heat. And so if we have electrodes inside the glass melt, we could, let's say, go to very high yields and very high efficiency, let's say, of electric melting. The issue is that we know that we could not go to 100%. Otherwise, we will have very big issue in terms of quality. So we try. We already, let's say, installed some electrification in the furnace, and we would like to go to maybe 50% of electrification. The remaining part will be applied with hydrogen of biogas, and maybe the remaining with CCU. So let's go, Jean, to the next phase, hydrogen.
Yes, of course, electrification is definitely the first way to test, but there are many cases for which electrification is not possible or maybe too complicated. So hydrogen is today an alternative when direct use of decarbonized electricity is not possible. And hydrogen has offers multi opportunities. First, hydrogen as an energy carrier and to use for combustion processes, and it may replace natural gas in furnaces. Second, hydrogen can act as reactive agent, and one key example is steel production. And the third point, last but not least, hydrogen as a storage solution. Hydrogen can offer a huge capacity to store electricity and help balancing the intermittent electricity provided by renewables. Big challenges for hydrogen. The first one, we assume that the need for hydrogen will be huge. So a need for high capacity for electrolyzers. So on the right side, you can see one of John Cockerill, 5 megawatt producing 1,000 normometer cube of hydrogen per hour. And this type of electrolyzer will be requested. And on the other side, you see an engineering study of what could be for the future for heavy industry, a big hydrogen production facility helping to supply hydrogen to the needs. So first target is capacity. And of course, second target will be to produce this hydrogen at as low cost as possible using decarbonized electricity. Could be green electricity, could be in some cases nuclear electricity. So we have seen electrification, we have seen hydrogen. Probably it will not be enough. CCUS will be needed. Jean-Yves, how do you see that?
Yes, so all the routes we have just explained by Jean and Marc are just dedicated to reduce the consumption of fossil fuel and to replace that by electricity or by hydrogen or even by biomass for some of them. But some of the process and most of the process, as illustrated on the next slide, emit other kind of CO2, and this is called so-called the process CO2. The process CO2 can represent up to two-thirds and sometimes 75% of the emission of the so-called non-metallic mineral industry, in which you have the cement industry, the lime business, the glass production, you have the steel production. It's the use of naturally occurring carbonated mineral who just provide those kind of emission. And of course, you cannot mitigate the emission of the process CO2 by just replacing the fuel. That's not possible at all. So how you do that? You just need to capture the CO2, being able to concentrate it, clean it up, to store it, transport it, and then either sequester it, inject in sequestration site, in depleting oil reservoir or in aquifer, or to use it, to transform it. And we will have some example later on in the presentation on the way we can transform CO2 into a valuable product. So the very important part, of course, is just how do we tackle, and we'll see that a bit more with the ECO2 project, how do we tackle with the capture and the concentration? How do we tackle with those emissions we cannot reduce by using electricity and hydrogen, which is certainly in Wallonia one of the critical emissions because part of those businesses are located in our country. Now I will invite Jean to explain how we can combine those CCU technology together with the hydrogen network and combine that together, because for CCU most of the time we do need hydrogen to be combined with CO2. Jean, please.
So we know that the future of energy, electricity in Europe will be with renewables, and this will supply the electrical network, be used by various players, various industrial in particularly. We have seen also that hydrogen can play a role to store electricity by electrolysis of water, supplying hydrogen. And we have seen that combining hydrogen and CO2, we can produce methane, named e-methane, that can be fed to the network. So we see that we can create a link between the electrical network and the gas network, taking advantage of various solutions given by renewables plus the technology to use renewables. So one good example in Wallonia is the Columbus project. So three players in Wallonia, Carmeuse, lime producer, John Cockerill, hydrolyzer manufacturer, and Engie, big electricity and energy provider, they've set this, this project. The idea here is to capture the CO2 from the lime kiln, as we know, producing lime generates CO2 in a natural way, cannot be avoided. Combining this CO2 with hydrogen produced with green electricity by the John Cockerill electrolyzer and using a technology of methanation provided by StoreEnergy, so a subsidiary of Engie, this will help to produce e-methane that will be injected in the network. So Columbus is not the single example, and now Marc will explain us another example provided by AGC.
Yes, this is a small example, of course, if we speak about, let's say, quantity of CO2 that we capture, but this is a real example. In fact, it's based on a furnace that we have in Germany, and that have a neighbor that is a greenhouse. Tomato, let's say, not only tomato. And what we do is supply already heat and rainwater to the greenhouse. And now what we will do is to supply also the CO2. So we will, of course, take the CO2 from our float plants, we'll clean it, dry, compress, and then deliver to the neighborhood, let's say, greenhouse. They will expand the size of the greenhouse. They will double, in fact, the size, and it will represent about 3% of our CO2. This is a small example. This is a good example because it's already, let's say, it will be done this year. So let's have a focus now on Wallonia and on the fact that we have to move fast. And between, let's say, a consortium of companies that you will see on the next slide, we decide, let's say, to create a project that will apply all that we have just shown. Jean, could you explain the consortium?
Yes, so ECO2 is an initiative of various enterprises in Wallonia, and you have seen all these enterprises. In fact, 20 partners, 3 main teams, and 5 technological axes. And the target is clearly to develop and validate the solution to decarbonize the industry, and also to generate synergies between all these players, because we know and we have seen in the beginning of the presentation that a lot of technologies, yes, have been demonstrated, but are not yet matured or ready for implementation. And we consider that working together will help to accelerate and to do it in a better way. The first action, the first axe of this project is electrification. We have seen that it is the first step to do. And here we have various players. So we see in the glass sector with HEC, in the stainless steel sector with Aperam, John Cockerill with thermal conversion of material, and with a research center like CRM, small and medium company like GPIA, and also universities. And the aim is to test a few solutions, for example, technology to be able to use electricity at a very high temperature. Do we have the material for that? Also to develop mathematical models to be able tomorrow to design the equipment. And also the idea is to perform some tests on some pilot equipment to validate what we have imagined as a transition to electrification. So the second axis, hydrogen, and hydrogen first, producing hydrogen with electrolysis. So in the former slide, we talked about huge consumer of hydrogen, but we know that in our industrial landscape, the need for combustion is variable. Not all the industries will need huge volume. And also, there will be a transition period where people would like to test at a low level the use of hydrogen. So the idea is to develop solution to do that, develop small size containerized solution, improve the efficiency, and also provide support to be able to test that. So here again, we have some companies, some the same as already mentioned, also various universities. Important point also is to, here again, to develop the modelization aiming at designing for the future the solution for each client. So we have seen electrification, we have seen producing hydrogen by electrolysis, but is electrolysis the only solution to produce hydrogen?
No. This is not the only solution. There is another solution that we work on the third axis, and that's called, let's say, a plasmolysis of methane. And so if we look to the previous one, this is something that is available. Of course, we would like to improve, reduce the cost and so on electrolysis. But if we look to another opportunity, it's really to transform our plasma CH4 into carbon and hydrogen. And we know that this is only at the lab scale for the time being. We have small equipment that are producing, so this is working. And this is the main advantage of this technology, is that it uses up to 8 times less energy than electrolysis. So this is very interesting because, as we mentioned, we will need a lot of energy, a lot of hydrogen, sorry, and low-cost hydrogen. And so the main goal of this axis will be, let's say, to move from the lab scale. You see the pictures of the current lab equipment at Maternova, to move from that one to a lab scale, to a pre-industrial pilot, and to an industrial production as far as possible. So that's really a challenge. And so we build a consortium for that. So we have Maternova, where the equipment is there, and they have, let's say, some patents. We'll work with John Cockerill, Ionix, Grow, AGC Plasma, so the plasma part of, let's say, of the AGC, let's say, glass. And we have also some interesting, let's say, partners. So, of course, Luminous, EDF, because they would like to utilize either hydrogen. But Gazonor, we could not only use, let's say, methane coming from the tubes, but we could also use methane coming from the mines, the remaining, the grisou, as we call it. And of course, we have also biomethane suppliers that are interested to provide methane to this plasma technology. So let's speak about the axe number 4. So this is so using hydrogen, it's not so much easy. So meaning burning hydrogen is completely different than burning methane. And depending on the industry, the challenge is bigger. And generally, We have always to test it on real case. It's very complex to test in lab. Very quickly, we have to go to, let's say, big scale. And so this is a technical solution for 100%, let's say, hydrogens. The influence of hydrogens on the product, on glass, for example, making burning hydrogen will bring, let's say, more water inside the glass. So this is an effect on the properties and on the quality. So developing digital model for, but we would like also to adapt that model with hydrogen combustions and change the design of the furnace. That's obviously will not be the same. So that's our task. Our purpose is the feasibility of the 100% hydrogen process. Identify the risk, mitigate those risks, set up the knowledge, and you see the partners are, let's say, the same that has been presented, let's say, on the previous axis nearby. So let's speak about CO2 capture and concentrations, Jean.
Thank you. So what makes really the ECO2 unique, I believe, in such kind of project is to have a transversal approach of the CO2 problems, starting from the fuel, production of the fuel and hydrogen, using of hydrogen, alternative innovative way of producing hydrogen, and finally, for what you cannot avoid by the conventional replacement of your fuel, the capture and the concentration. The AX5 is just dedicated to that specific purpose, mainly to tackle with the unavoidable process CO2, as I was mentioning a bit before. Two different pillars. The first pillar is how could we modify the existing process in such a way that inside the process you can concentrate the CO2. Most of the current process in the EV industry produce a CO2 diluted at 20%, but we need up to 90%+ to be able to transport it and sequester it or to modify it by utilization or transformation. And then we need really to concentrate that. So the first pillar is how do I modify that? And we have two approach, one in the phosphorus business. That's a project led by Préon, and one led by my company Carmers, to modify the current best available technology in such a way that we produce a pure stream of CO2 at the end. Beside that, we have a second mutualized project, which is just between a lot of different companies, glass, steel, phosphate again, and lime, where we try to develop solution called so-called end of pipe. So we put add-on or technology after the production of the CO2, and the technology are expected to take, capture, concentrate to be ready for sequestration. The so-called end of pipe solution, the objective is to mutualize all our effort and to test different options, technical options, technico-economically screened, and then with the best of the in class, we'll build a pilot and the pilot will be used by the different owners. So that's really, for me, a unique consortium when we have a big impact. And now we unfortunately arrive at the end of our presentation, and I would like to present you the major takeaway and a big message we'd like to pass and as a conclusion. First of all, you have seen that in this big transversal project, we have a lot of work to do, and that's really a big challenge in terms of impact, of course, and the difficulty of the various technology we have to implement. So first, we have to work and work hard. The second message is, of course, that we do not have turnkey solution on the shelf ready yet. We need to upscale that and upscale that at the demonstration level as soon as we can, like explained by Marc. So we really need development phase and research and development with university and research center.
The third message is to speak that we are working with ECO2 on hydrogen productions, hydrogen usage, electrification and CO2 capture.
So this makes the name of our project. ECO2 in French, HECO2, and initiated by various players and a lot of industrial, but also academics and also research center and SMEs. Have in mind that this industry involved in represents around 21% of CO2 emission in Wallonia from the industrial sector. And our aim in the midterm is to cut this emission by around 25%. So it's a big challenge. So we need to be working all together, and it's time to accelerate, so let's do it, let's accelerate. And to finish, we'll be ready all together to answer these questions. Thank you in advance.
Thank you for your attention.